Rock of Fights come to you live from the city that never sleeps, Las Vegas, Nevada, the entertainment capital of the world that hosts so many major sporting events, spotlights professional kickboxing as Draka presents two Intercontinental Championship fights. Tonight, in our main event, we have super heavyweights Andrei Dubko of Belarus taking on Frenchman Tony Gregory for the Intercontinental title. And in our co-main event, for the lightweight Intercontinental Championship, it's Sadibek Iskiev of Kyrgyzstan going up against the American challenger, Alfonso Alcaraz. We have fighters representing nine countries in a total of eight exciting fights tonight, all right here from the magnificent Orleans Hotel and Casino, where players from all over the world come to enjoy the famous restaurants, luxurious surroundings, and of course, the great gaming. It's a beautiful spring evening here at the Orleans Hotel and Casino. The weather's warming up, the tables are heating up, and the action in the ring will be red and hot tonight. Hi, I'm Chip Coast coming to you live from the Orleans Hotel and Casino here in Las Vegas, Nevada. And I'm joined by the legendary superstar kickboxing champion and action movie star, Don the Dragon Wilson. Don, fill us on what we have in store for tonight.
Well, the main event's going to be really a great fight. I mean, Andrei Dubko versus Tony Gregory. Tony Gregory, the French champion. Dubko coming off a big win on the K-1 this year in March. I mean, this guy is a knockout fighter. It'll be a 10-round fight for the Intercontinental Super Heavyweight Championship. Dubko's record, 26-2, 23 KOs, great knockout record. He's a Shotokan stylist in traditional martial arts. He's the Wako European World Heavyweight Champion. This guy's got a lot of titles. He's been training here in Vegas for quite a while now. He's in good shape, and he says he's here to do it tonight.
Well, you've described the Goliath. Let's hear what you know about Anthony Gregory.
Well, we don't know a lot about him. This is his first fight in the States, but he's 16-2 with 16 KOs, kickboxing champion of France. We know he's proud. We talked to him today, and he's really, really confident. He says he's going to be a spoiler. These heavyweights get together. It's going to be exciting.
Now, the co-main event tonight is going to be Sadibek Iskiev versus Alfonso Alcaraz. What do we know about this guy from Kyrgyzstan, Iskiev?
I know a lot about him. I've seen him fight four times. He's a technician in the ring. Not a great knockout fighter, but he's a technician. Alcaraz, he's a grappler. We don't really know that much about him. Iskiev, Eurasian kickboxing champion, Asian free fighting champion, Draka Intercontinental champion. 28-4-2 records, 12 KOs. Like I said, he's not a knockout fighter. He's a technician. He's in great shape. He's here to do it tonight.
Well, Alfonso Alcaraz, what do we know about him? I know he's from California, and he did some wrestling in college.
He's the U.S. Muay Thai Association North American champion. This guy knows how to kickbox, but he's also a grappler. He's got a wrestling background, very versatile. WKA U.S. champion, IFCA world champion. This guy is not here to lose. This is his home country, the USA. He wants to do it for America, he says.
Okay, coming up, as they say, let's get ready to rumble as we have Edmund Terabidian versus Alan Flores.
Well, it's action time here tonight, Don. You must get excited every time you come here to the ring. This first fight is going to be a four-rounder junior welterweight. What do you know about these fighters?
Well, I'll tell you one thing. This Edmund from Armenia, I mean, he's out here to show that he's ready to start competing in international competition. I mean, he hasn't fought here in the States. This will be his first fight here, and I'm looking forward to seeing him fight.
And Alan Flores, now he's a local from Los Angeles, California.
Yeah, as I understand it, these guys actually have met in the ring in the past. They each have one win against each other, and this is kind of a grudge match, rubber match. This will decide who's the best.
Okay, well, we're looking forward to the rubber match. You've had the opportunity to travel to Armenia, haven't you, Tom?
Yeah, they got some great fighters there. I mean, and tonight we're going to see a good example of it. They're well-trained. I mean, they're prepared in kickboxing. They've been doing it since the 80s. You know, it became legal over there on the Russian part of the world in 1980, and they've been doing it ever since.
Now, the trainer in the corner for the Armenian fellow, he's a legendary trainer from Armenia, isn't he?
Yes. Ken Artunian is one of the best trainers. I mean, he's got a school in California, trains a lot of great champions.
All right. Dick Halk to ringside, please. Dick Halk to ringside.
Tarverdian is 19 years of age, height of 5'10", weighing 142, with a reach of 76. His reach is definitely over Flores, who has a little more pounds on him, but is a little shorter in a couple of years his youth. Now let's go live to the ring announcer, Dick Gutierrez.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Orleans Hotel and Casino here in fabulous Las Vegas, Nevada, where tonight, Draka Incorporated, in association with the Orleans Hotel and Casino, Ringside Magazine, Guilty Sportswear, Staraya Vodka, Dolgoruki Vodka, and NTV International are proud to present International Kickboxing World Championships on Dish Network. Tonight's bouts are sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission. The chairman is Dr. Elias Ghanem. Ladies and gentlemen, all bouts this evening will consist of 2-minute rounds. At this time, we bring you our first bout, a special 4-round amateur attraction in the junior welterweight division. Three judges at ringside are Danny Stell, Dick Houck, and Al Lefkowitz. And introducing your referee in charge, Steve Mazzagatti. Introducing first, he fights out of the red corner. He's wearing the black trunks, and he weighed in at 142 pounds. He is from Karavakan, Armenia. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Edmund Tarwedian. And his opponent across the ring, he fights out of the blue corner. He's wearing blue trimmed in gold, and he weighed in at 146 pounds. He comes to us from Los Angeles, California. Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Alan Flores.
You notice he's wearing the Muay Thai gear, traditional gear, which means to me he's done a lot of Thai boxing, which is a very, very rough sport.
Don, will this be Muay Thai rules?
No, it will not. These are drawcard fights. There will be regular kickboxing rules, no throws.
What's going to be a little different?
Well, it's going to be a little different in the fact that during the course of the bout, if anyone is knocked down 3 times, and not in just 1 round, but at any time in the bout will be stopped. So that's kind of like an added safety factor for the fights tonight.
Traditionally, it has to be 3 rounds, in three knockdowns in each round. Is that correct?
Right. That's normally the way it is in boxing and kickboxing. But tonight, it'll be 3 during any time during the bout. Flores with the gold stripe, I guess. We'll have to distinguish him between Trevidian with just black shorts.
Well, Tarvidian fighting out of the red corner. I noticed that they're not wearing any type of boots.
No, sometimes they wear the safety kicks, they call them, the foam pads, but not tonight. They sometimes allow fighters to wear them if they want, but tonight doesn't look like they're wearing them.
Scoring is going to be the same here, Don. 10-point must system.
Correct. Generally, though, judges tend to favor kicks over punches in kickboxing.
So we get the name.
This is the feeling out process. They're testing each other right now.
Well, I wouldn't want to feel any of that, Don. I already noticed welts on the leg of Tarvinian.
Well, you know, they hit with not just the foot. These fighters are hitting with their shins, which is like getting hit by the baseball bat.
You fought this style, have you, Don?
Yeah, I fought many fights without foot gear.
Have you ever fought Draka?
I did an exhibition in Draka once with the throws. They will allow a grab for a 2 count here, so that may look a little different than what people are traditionally used to seeing here in the States. These are modified Draka rules. Oh, that was a good right hand. I think that's the first telling blow of the bout.
Coming down to our first round of action. It's just a feeling out process. End of round one.
Well, they were feeling each other out, but I think Edmund did land the more telling blows. I saw 2 or 3 good, clean hits. I think the judges, you know, unofficially, I'd give that round to Edmund.
Spear's very close. Now, do they usually fight 2-minute rounds or 3-minute rounds when it's Draka? I know in Muay Thai, it's usually 3-minute rounds.
Well, these would be 2-minute rounds, which kind of ends to pick up the action. You know, the audience is very audience-friendly. The audience likes it when the fighters are not pacing themselves, as fighters are known to do with the longer rounds, longer times in the rounds.
These gloves look smaller. Is this a standard 8-ounce glove?
Right. This weight class would be fighting with eights, and when they move up, it'll be 10-ounce gloves.
All right. Beginning round two. It's amazing how 1 minute can refresh you in the corner, huh?
Well, these fighters are trained for that. I mean, they should be able to expend as much energy as they want and still recuperate within 1 minute.
See some high kicks going here.
Well, I like one thing Forrest is doing. He seems to be working the legs. And usually when a fighter wants to kick to the head, he'll work the legs and then shoot one up to the head.
How much punishment can the legs take, man?
Well, this is a four-round fight. I don't anticipate anybody being stopped with a kick to the leg, but fighters can be stopped. A good inside kick there by Flores. And, you know, you have to remember, these kicks are hitting scoring areas, so they're scoring points out there with these low kicks.
Now, when you say low kicks, can you kick? You can't kick below the knees, actually.
Yes, you can. You can kick below the knee. You can kick the outside of the thigh. You cannot kick the groin. You cannot actually kick the knee.
Those have got to hurt for the thigh. Now, there we saw a throw, right?
No, not really. That will be not counted as a knockdown. I believe Flores is going to have to put some pressure on Edmund. If he wants to win this fight, he can't stay outside. He does not have the reach or the technique and the speed that he's going to need to score points on the outside on Edmund.
Or the luxury of rounds, a four-round fight. If you're behind after two, it's a catch-up game from there.
Right, it's a short fight. He needs to pick the pace up and put more pressure on. I mean, I like the way he's working the leg, but he's got to start shooting some shots upstairs, hands and feet. Oh, another good right hand by Edmund.
I like his high kick style.
Oh, it just missed. I mean, and that kick with the weight of the leg, that would have been a good knockdown, if not a KO.
Well, the crowd seems to like it too.
Yeah, I think right now Flores has got to be rethinking his game plan here. He can't sit on the outside and play a cautious game. I'm sure his trainers are telling him that now.
Well, Terabidian seemed to come back at the end of that second round, and it might have been a little closer than you were earlier anticipating.
Both rounds have been close, but I'm still leaning towards Tavidian. You know, if you watch this kick, goes right down to the leg, and I think he comes then to the head. Now, that was the takedown or the push. Since Edmund is from Armenia, I'm sure he's used to the normal international Draka style, which is throws actually count. But in this case here in Vegas, that was just counted as a slip.
All right, we're ready for action. Round three.
They're cleaning up some water. You can't have water left in the corner at the beginning of a round.
I guess it causes a slip. I mean.
Right, but it's a very, Flores does train in the Muay Thai style, and they dump a lot of water on their fighters in Thailand.
You need to cool down between rounds, I guess.
Well, Flores needs to pick up the pace and put some pressure on Edmund if he's going to win this.
Once again, Edmund does have a reach. I suppose that helps in the later rounds.
Oh, the reach will help in any round. He scored with the foot, and he scored with a good right hand, so he's using the reach. He's in no hurry, though. Watch him now. He's like a tiger getting ready to pounce. He's well-trained by Ken Artunian. I mean, Ken was a champion Draka fighter himself, his trainer.
Well, in the Soviet Army, they trained also. I think Ken was a former member of the Soviet Army before the breakup of the republics.
Oh, good shot. Wow. That's going to score high with the judges. You know, they call this kickboxing, and kicks do score to the face. You get a lot more credit than a punch or a jab to the face.
Well, it certainly scored high with the crowd.
Yeah, it's always exciting for the audience to see a flashy head kick. Oh, that's Looks like Flores got one in there. He needs to keep that up. Spinning back fist to score, but not a lot of damage.
I see a lot of sweat fly on those. Is that coming from the glove or the head?
That comes from the head, unfortunately. It's a good bout. This is very even. I mean, both these guys are showing a lot of respect for each other, but there's a lot of action.
Oh, now that's a technique that you were telling me earlier, where you can grab the leg.
They're going to call that a slip, but, you know, there was a punch in there somewhere. I mean, that was a close call.
Yeah, under round three, we got one more exciting round here.
But unofficially, I would give that an even round. I didn't see anybody really dominating, but I do know that Flores has got to pick up the pace here in the last round. I mean, this is a four-round fight, and it's all over depending on this round. This is the kick to the head, I believe. Right there, just grazed him. Now, that had that landed flush on the face, that would have been the end of it. That would have been the end of the fight. There's the catch in the right hand. Now, that could have potentially been called a knockdown in the sense that he grabbed him, but the punch is what put him down. He didn't push him down. It was not a push or a slip. It was actually a right hand. Referee chose to call it more of a slip. No point awarded to Edmund.
Well, fourth and final round in a close fight here.
Now, see, I would say this is wrong with Flores. He should be all over Edmund in this round, letting it all go and just tossing the bombs. It's not a time for cat and mouse game now. Good counter there by Edmund, right over the top of the glove.
Flores is trying to pressure him, but...
Oh, he's trying, but, you know, Edmund knows it, and he's countering well. He's waiting. He's waiting for him. He's got to feel he's a little ahead. You see, he's not putting a lot of pressure. He's playing a counter game.
Once again, there's the grab.
But they're allowed to grab for a two count.
Now, is it a penalty if they hold longer?
I believe the referee would just break them, maybe give a warning if it happens too often, but... it's not a major penalty. And the right hand is more or less glancing right hand, but it's been the big gun for his punches. I mean, he hasn't landed any jabs, but that right hand has gotten in.
Well, we have about a minute to go here. Someone's got to make a decision. Who's going to put the pressure on?
Well, Flores should be. I mean, I'm not the judge, but... I think Edmund's ahead, and these Armenian fighters are very hard. Good right hand. Again, clean score. Not a lot of effect, I see. I mean, definitely Flores got a chin, but that's not going to help if you get scored on. The style with the hands up that Edmund's doing, that is a Muay Thai style. It lends for blocking roundhouse kicks, but... straight kicks and straight punches can slip in with those, that wide stance he's got with his hands.
You also got to watch for the knees, too, right?
Well, they won't be using any knees tonight.
Well, that's it. This one's too close for me to call. I guess it's in the hands of the judges.
Well, I think Edmund Tavarian from Armenia believes he's won. He's the only one holding his hand up out there. I think Flores, although he didn't put a lot of pressure on, he must have known he was behind.
Well, he did win in the early rounds, but I think you're quite right. He needed to put pressure on that last round and make a final deciding.
Fuck my wife, don't you?
I know.
Sorry,
we failed. Knees are kind of
getting on.
Now, this is judged by three judges. Is that correct?
Right. It's... same as boxing, same as kickboxing, very standard. Tatraka Incorporated promoting these bouts, but they are not using the full international Draka rules tonight.
Those would be the ones that would allow...
I believe that was the right-hand counter there. And that's probably really why, Chip, you know, we're talking about Flores moving in. I think Flores had the intent to move in, but, you know, when you're getting punched in the face and kicked in the head with good, clean counters, it's tough to be aggressive.
Nothing.
All right, here we're coming. We have a decision. We're going up to Jake Gutierrez, the ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, after four rounds of this junior welterweight bout, we go to the scorecards. We have a unanimous decision. Judges Al Lefkowitz and Dick Houck each scored the bout 40-36, and Judge Danny Still scored the bout 39-37 for the winner by unanimous decision. In the red corner, Edmund Tarverian.
Hey, I called one right. That's unusual for me. I should have been a matchmaker.
Well, the Armenian has come away with the victory in this rubber match here. Very, very happy, Edmund Tarverian.
Well, you know, that's a dangerous move. You know, when you've been fighting, you do that backflip. If you're a little tired or you've been dazed a little bit, you can get hurt. Great fight, great show.
Good trainer in corner. Good job, good job. Coming up now, we'll have Douglas Evans of Redwood City, California, fighting Peter Kaljevac, formerly out of Montenegro, Yugoslavia, and now out of New York. This will be a six-round middleweight fight. It's a featured event.
Douglas fight a few times. I mean, he's a rugged guy. I was in Yerevan in Armenia when he fought. He got a shoulder injury. He was stopped in that fight, but he is very aggressive and tough guy. He looks like he means business tonight, too.
Well, it's got to be a serious moment getting into the ring as we see the fighter coming out to his style of music.
Well, you know there's somebody in there looking to do some harm to you, so this is a serious moment for any fighter coming into the ring.
Now these fighters are going to be using the heavier gloves, the 10-ounce, it's a middleweight fight.
Right, they'll be wearing 10-ounce gloves.
You fought with all different weights of gloves. Muay Thai has been 5-ounce in Thailand and then 8-ounce.
Yeah, but you know, in America, things are pretty standardized because of the boxing commissions here and the athletic commissions. We keep things in kickboxing and in Draka pretty much in tune with what the athletic commissions and the boxers are doing.
I assume this is for safety purposes that you go to the heavier weight for the glove. And now here we see Peter Kaljevac of Montenegro, Yugoslavia. He's looked like he's been in a number of fights himself.
Yeah, well, you know, he's 32 years old. He's no spring chicken, but, you know, in kickboxing, you can last a little bit longer than boxing, believe it or not. There's less strikes to the head, less cuts. You can have a longer career. 32 is not old for a kickboxer. He lives now in New York from Yugoslavia, and I'm sure he's still got a lot of pride from the country he's come from, and he's looking to prove that he can defend his country's honor here tonight. It's a very international card.
I know a little bit about this fighter. I put on a show in New York City one time, and Peter Kaljevac was one of the main events. He fought the entire fight with a broken jaw. Got it the first punch of the evening. Fought the whole fight. Ended up losing in a split decision. This kid comes to fight.
You know what to do, baby. That's right.
Okay, here we have the call of the tape. There's a hometown record for Douglas Evans of Redwood City, California. 17-5 with 7 KOs. He's 28 years of age, 5'8" in height, 161 pounds, 70. Peter Kaljevac, he's 32 years old.
Tail of the tape, Evans is 28 years old.
He's 5'8", 161 pounds, 70-inch reach. These guys are really evenly matched. Kaljevic, 32 years old, 5'9", 157, 70-inch reach. Really evenly matched, guys. Both of them are proud. It's going to be a great fight.
All right, let's go up to our ring announcer, Jake Gutierrez.
Ladies and gentlemen, we now go to the professional boxers. This bout is scheduled for 6 rounds in the middleweight division. Our three judges are Nelson Hamilton, Dave Moretti, and Dalby Shirley. Introducing your referee in charge of this bout, we have Chuck Hurricane Kid Simonini. Introducing first, he's fighting out of the red corner. He's wearing black trimmed in red, and he weighed in at 161 pounds. He comes to us from Redwood City, California, with a professional record of 17 wins with 5 defeats, 7 wins by knockout. Ladies and gentlemen, here is Douglas Evans. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing white trimmed in blue, he weighed in at 157 pounds. He comes to us from Montenegro, Yugoslavia, and he now lives and fights out of Brooklyn, New York. He's a veteran of 60 fights with a record of 45 wins, 14 defeats, 1 draw, 17 wins by knockout. Introducing Peter Kaljevic.
Well, it seems like each fighter has some fans in the crowd tonight.
I tell you, Kaljevic has got a lot more experience than Evans.
You break. You listen to what I have to say. Okay, touch buzz, God bless, good luck.
Well, he's got 17 knockouts, Peter Kaljevic does.
This will be a 6-round bout. We've got Evans from the Redwood City, California, with a black trunks. Peter Kaljevic, you from Yugoslavia, fighting out of New York, in the white trunks.
And you said you saw Evans fight earlier in Armenia, was it?
Yeah, he's a great fighter. He doesn't quite have the experience of Kaljevic, but I imagine he's going to try to make up with it with his intensity.
Now again, here we have Kaljevic and Evans are both wearing the traditional Muay Thai shorts.
Hey, wake up, please. Wake back. Step back. You know, Evans starts with the first big punch, but Jonas, one of the signs of inexperience is to start a little hard. More experienced fighters start slower.
Seems to be lunging a little.
Could be dangerous for him the way he's coming into that right. Kaljevic is a southpaw, and you know, you don't want to just be coming in and throwing right hands on a southpaw, because he's got a good counter left, I'm sure, that you'd be looking right into if you get in there for a long time.
Just talking to Kaljevic before the fight, he's fought all kinds of styles. American rules, kickboxing.
A good hook kick there. Nice clean hook kick. You see now Evans putting his hand up trying to protect. I mean, that could start a cut. If you don't have a pad on your foot and your heel hits somebody's head, you could easily cut him. I see Evans now keeping his right hand up. That hook kick made him aware of it. There it goes. There's the right hand up there protecting his head.
I think that hook is something you're famous for, you
know? Well, I like to use it. You know, I like to fight southpaw like this. And, you know, that and the side kick. I don't see Kaljevic using the side kick, but that hook kick was right on the money. See, Evans keeps leading with that right hand. Sometimes they tell you to use that against a southpaw, but in the kickboxing match is a little riskier because that right leg can catch you coming in.
Yeah, once again, he seems to be lunging with it.
Oh. Knockdown or more of a slip, but he slipped trying to land a kick to the head.
That foot went over the head.
He's coming with some evil intentions, that's for sure. Unofficially, I'd say that's pretty even round for me. You see both fighters just sitting back relaxing. I mean, they're both very experienced, and you know, that's a mark of a fighter that's been through a lot of wars, is they don't do it all in the first round.
In the traditional Muay Thai fight, six rounds in every fight?
No, it kicks you. In Thai boxing, they do five rounds. Just over the head there, you see. But that was some evil intent, as they say. He was trying to land a knockout kick. So Evans is starting off trying to get inside. He is fighting a fighter with a little more reach than him, so his strategy, I believe, is to get inside.
There you go. The technique where they sweep it.
Right, they will not be calling sweeps as knockdowns, as they do in some Draka fights. There was a good right hand there, and in fact, some real clean shots there by Evans.
He looks like he's got
mixing up well. He's landing some good kicks low to the legs. He's landing some good punches to the head.
Kalcevic's having trouble getting out of the corner.
Well, I think he got a little bit stunned in one of those shots. I mean, for him to be covering up like that. It's a six-round fight, so Evans is able to utilize a lot of energy in there right now. It's not a 12-round fight.
Well, once again, you said he's an early starter.
Good right hand. Very impressed with the hand work that Evans is doing. You see that grab now? That's okay for 2 seconds, but that's it. The referee is warning him he's got to release if he doesn't do something within a two count.
That right hand seems to be landing.
Oh, yeah, but you know what? That low kick inside, that did the damage.
I guess if you take the legs out of your body.
That was a close call. That hook kick went right over Evans' head. I mean, you don't want to get so aggressive that you forget about defense. One of the things that's happened here, Chip, is that Evans blew out a little bit of energy, a little too much energy at the beginning of this round. He's pitching around slow.
I think Kalcevic came back with a little bit too late.
Well, I'm not so sure if it's really a comeback as it was a letdown by Evans. Evans just kind of burned up a little bit too much gas there at the beginning of the round. Oh, no. You know what that shoulder, that in Armenia, Yerevan, a year ago, he fought, that shoulder went out, he had to stop fighting. I hope it's not the same injury. He's had it before. I've seen this happen before. He was doing great, and his shoulder went out.
He's obviously in a lot of pain.
Well, I don't think they're going to let him fight if he's got one arm. That this might be it. I mean, I think he's winning the fight, but they may. And I hate
the referees
this.
Called it, Tom.
This is a shame. This is a shame. Yeah, I think that's going to be it. The doctor's not going to allow him to continue. He was winning the fight. Unofficially, I mean, I feel he was in control, but...
Well, clearly he was ahead the first two rounds, but as you pointed out earlier, safety is primary. Even though this is a violent sport, there still have to be rules and parameters on the safety and concerns of the fighters.
Yeah, Peter Kalcevic gets it. It's a win. I'm sure it's not the way he wants to win. I mean, he's a great fighter. I'm sure he'd rather win in a more decisive, convincing way, but that was a good win. A win is a win. I mean, I'll take him like that.
Kalcevic going over to see how the opponent is.
Right. Same one. Same shoulder. I think, unfortunately, Douglas Evans has a reoccurring injury, and that's the kind of injury that could stop your career.
Certainly going to affect his future. Certainly going to affect his future.
A reoccurring problem.
This will probably be going down as a
the problem
a
is,
KO, I believe.
See, this isn't a dislocation. If there's three ligaments,
a situation where a fighter is unable to continue because of an injury.
And that technical knockout.
Yeah, it should be. I believe it should be a TKO.
Well,
we're going
ringside. You can try and get orthoscopic or orthopedic evaluation, but once you injure, it's got to be healed correctly or it's got to be there.
Many times, if this happens in the first round, they'll call it a no contest.
Like
but I don't think that will be the case tonight.
All right, let's go up to Jake Gutierrez for the official decision.
But not yet.
Ladies and gentlemen, this bout ends at the end of the second round due to a dislocated shoulder to the fighter in the red corner. Therefore, the winner by TKO victory, Peter Kalievich.
Well, we called it. It was a TKO. Fight was very even. It was looking like Evans was gaining some control, but near the end of the round, he did let up, and I guess I thought he was tired. I guess it was the injury.
I suppose for record purposes, it is important that that does go down as a TKO as opposed to a nine still
counter. No, it
doesn't show.
No. They call it that kissing your sister. It means nothing.
Okay, coming up, super lightweight fight, Barzat Mirzayan versus Ben Garcia.
Mirzayan is the ISCKF World Karate Champion. Now, karate is not kickboxing, but it shows there's a certain amount of skill level involved. He's a WKUS champion, which is kickboxing. He's got a not very much of a record, 7-1 with 3 KOs, but, you know, he's a tough guy and well-trained, and he's, you know, we talked to him earlier today. He's ready for action. You know, this is a lot of young fighters here tonight making their mark at Draka.
Well, we see him coming to the ring. He certainly looks focused.
Yeah, I see he's trained by Ken Artunian again. He was the, you know, his fighter won already tonight. And, you know, Ken is used to bringing fighters up right. I mean, I imagine that his opponent has been well-picked to be evenly matched and should be a great, exciting fight.
That's right. Edmund Tarbinian earlier won, trained by Ken. And this next fight, Barzat Mirzayan, should be an exciting one. Okay, this is Ben Garcia. He's the WKC World Champion and the IKKC World Champion. His record's 24-1 with 7 KOs. He's from my hometown, Chicago, Illinois. I'm picking the red corner.
He's got a lot more of a record than Mahiranian, but you know, we'll see tonight, Chip. We'll see.
He's marching in, 25 years old, 136 pounds. He's trained by Master Toddy, who originally had a school in Manchester, England, and is now over here in the United States training fighters.
Yeah, I see Master Toddy there, and I see also they're wearing the traditional Thai headdress. You see that several of the fighters tonight are coming in with that. They're well acquainted with the Muay Thai style here in Las Vegas, but this is Draka. It's a little bit different, and you know, he is fighting one of the Armenian fighters, very experienced at this style of fighting.
Ben Garcia, on the side, is the disc jockey over at the Hard Rock Cafe here in Las Vegas. He's the one who spins the records and, I guess, takes care of them when there's problems on the dance floor, too.
Now, Garcia's got almost three times the fights of Mehranian, but they're not Draka fights. You know, this is the one thing about martial arts competition. The rules change all the time. You got to stay on top of it. Well, let's take a look at the tail of the tape here. We'll look at how these guys match up. They're both young. Mehranian is 21. He's 5'5", 138 pounds, 70-inch reach. Garcia, 25. It's a wash there. 5'11", a little taller. 136 pounds, lean, much longer reach, so 76-inch reach. Wow. You know, when you got the reach with your arms, you got the reach with your feet. So he should be trying to stay outside if he follows traditional styles, body styles versus fighting styles. The taller guy usually stays outside.
You know, Barzat went over to Thailand and fought.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the Orleans Hotel and Casino, we bring you a special six-round super lightweight bout using the Muay Thai rules. Those rules allow the boxers to hold and use their knees. Judges at ringside scoring this bout will be Danny Stell, Dick Houck, and Al Lefkowitz. Introducing your referee in charge, we have Cecil Peoples. Introducing first, he fights out of the red corner. He's wearing the navy blue trunks, trimmed in silver, and he weighed in at 138 pounds. He comes to us from Yerevan, Armenia. His record stands at 7 wins, only 1 defeat, 3 wins by knockout. Here is Verazat Mehranyan. And his opponent, fighting out of the blue corner, he's wearing the blue trunks and he weighed in at 136 pounds. He is from Chicago, Illinois, now living and fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada. His professional record is 20 wins, 4 defeats, 1 draw, 7 wins by knockout. Here is Ben Garcia.
Well, the crowd is certainly up for this fight, though.
Yeah, they both got fans here, but I tell you what, one thing that we didn't realize, and we should let the audience at home know, this will be under the modified tie rules. This will be the one bout tonight that actually they will be using the knees, and there will be some holding, so this really slants the fight towards Garcia. I mean, it's going to be a tough night for Mehranyan. This is not a traditional draka. This is more Muay Thai.
Now, the motions we see Garcia going through, is this traditional?
Yes, it is. They go through this dance. It's kind of like a fight dance where you're paying homage to the fighting spirit in the ring, and they usually will go from corner to post to corner post, but it's almost like a kind of a meditative thing.
Now, we're talking about the Thai rules. You're one of the Americans that went over to Thailand and won, and beat them at their best.
Actually, I lost that fight, Chip. I did not win in Thailand. I lost a decision. But I did fight under Thai rules in Hong Kong, and I won all my fights in Hong Kong. So I'm very familiar with what we're going to be seeing. One thing we will not see is the knee or the elbows. They use elbows in Thailand, but not here in Las Vegas.
Are kicks to the groin legal here?
No, no kicks to the groin.
I know you recognize the referee there, Cecil Peoples.
Yeah, great martial artist, great fighter himself. This looks to be a lopsided fight, but, you know, we'll know after the first round exactly how these guys match up. But Garcia, you know, with the Thai kickboxing and the training and this being Thai rules, Mehranyan is going to have his hands full.
Well, it's interesting. In 7-1 record, Mehranyan's loss was to Garcia in a split decision, so this is his rematch.
He wouldn't be getting in there if he didn't think he had a chance to win this.
A split decision means somebody thought he was favored.
Now, you notice the taller fighter, Garcia's moving forward. He is not content to stay outside and just score. He looks like he means business. He doesn't want this to go to a decision.
Oh, this is another quick start.
Well, I noticed the audience reacted to that low kick to the thigh that Garcia landed. That shows that the audience is actually very educated, because that is a good, clean score that has a damaging effect on a fighter. A kick from five. That was a sweep. Now, if this was a draka fight, he'd have scored points on that.
Now, he swept the back leg.
Right, which is legal in draka. Good right hand, just kind of glanced off Mehranyan. Garcia wants to get in with that right hand. Good left hook by Mehranyan.
Well, nobody's backing down this first round.
No, I think they did the feeling out process the first time they fought. This fight started at the opening bell with action.
This is a continuation.
Mehranyan tried a counter left hook there, didn't land, but I see what he's trying to do. He wants Garcia to throw that lead right, and he's trying to counter with the left hook.
There's the clutch. End of round one. How do you see it, Ben?
That round's too close to call, but a lot of action, and I see at the very end of the round, Garcia tried to get a knee in there. Now, the knee, for those that aren't familiar with it, has probably two or three times the force and the damage of a body punch. So if you see a clean knee to the body, it's going to do some damage. They will not be kneeing to the head, which is something they do in Thailand, but is illegal in the Nevada State Athletic Association's rule book. There'll be no elbows, no kneeing to the head.
Well, I see what you mean in Garcia's corner. Master Tide is applying a lot of water to try to cool down his fighter.
Yep. I think what we're going to see up here is a kick by Garcia that's a little bit low. It doesn't really land on the thigh. It's almost on the side of the butt. And, that's not the scoring area, and that's really not the damage area. I think you can take a good shot in the butt. What the fighters try to do is land their shins on each other's thighs. That's where the real damage is done.
Good combination.
Yeah, good. Mixing the hands well. That's the style of the evolved fighters today. They can punch and kick. They're not just kickers. Oh, good uppercut, which led to a left hook. Now, Raymond is really coming alive this round.
Well, both of them came to the dance here. He seems comfortable with the gloves.
Well, it's kind of hard, a guy with long legs like that, to outkick somebody with that kind of reach. I mean, it's you can see by the tail of the tape, they measure the arms, but when you look at those legs, Garcia's all leg. It's hard to kick a guy like that.
So, Marani, and then his goal should be to try to get inside?
No, absolutely. He's got to try to counter the feet with his hands. What I think he needs to do is when right after a kick like that, he needs to move in with the hands, just as with the foot still up in the air. In the fight business, they call it like a touch and go. As soon as you feel that foot move in. And again, when he gets in, he's getting locked up, which is legal in Thai boxing, to lock up around the head and hold your opponent and try to knee. And that may be what is putting a stymie on the Iranian's aggression tonight, that grabbing in the knee.
There's a 3-second hold, right?
Well, you can only hold for a 3 count. And you get the knee out, and then the referee will break you.
Boy, another good round of punishment both these fighters gave to each other.
I tell you, Mir Iranian has really got a tough puzzle to figure out here. This guy is tall, but he's also being very aggressive. He's good with the knees. More so, I think, than Mir Iranian. I mean, in Armenia, they fight Draka. They don't do the Muay Thai. They don't use the knees quite the same. And, he's got to figure this puzzle out in the next couple of rounds. He's only got 4 more rounds.
Now, Garcia's corner, trained by Master Tati, he mainly trains Thai fighters, right?
Well, he teaches them the Thai style because that's what Master Tati was, a Thai champion. So he teaches them that. But, kickboxers, we got to do everything. You got to fight the full Thai style. You got to fight many different styles when you're a kickboxer. Here's the beginning of the round. If you remember, he came on hard. Not very accurate, though. He did land a little bit of an uppercut. He looked like he was trying to get a jump on Garcia, try to catch him cold coming out of the corner, but didn't quite land anything.
Nothing really hit clean. Okay, round 3. This is to go 6 rounds.
You notice Miranian did not come out as aggressive this time. He's trying to figure out this puzzle. How's he going to get to this guy?
Go to the knee.
And those hurt. Also, he needs to use his hands, and that holding the head is something Thai boxers do when you want to punch, and it just stymies it. I mean, if they allowed holding in boxing, there'd be no boxing.
Good exchange here.
That was a pretty slick move. He came up underneath the left roundhouse and cut the back leg.
Seems to be very tenuous, Garcia, on that back leg right now from that foot. You can see a nice red welt forming.
Fights tend to like settle into a kind of a rhythm. And unless this rhythm has changed, I don't see Mehranian taking this fight because Garcia is the aggressor. He's coming forward. He's not back.
Now, is that a slip?
Well, that may be a knockdown. No, the referee did not call that a knockdown, dude. He did go down as a result of a technique. A couple of good, solid shots landed by the Iranian there on Garcia's head, a couple of punches.
The Barzot certainly is the aggressive boxer here, but...
Yeah, he has to be. I think he's got to get in there.
Garcia seems to be enjoying himself. Has a smile on his face.
Well, you know, fighters got to do a little acting in the ring. I mean, I do a little acting, a little fighting, but sometimes if you're not winning, you got to act like you're winning. And when you get hurt, you got to act like you're not hurt.
You know,
so it's part of fighting.
Those shins must take a lot of punishment. How do you train your legs to take that kind of punishment?
You don't. You don't really. I mean, you train your mind to withstand the pain. You don't train your legs to be deadened from the pain. I mean, I believe that's a fallacy when they talk about these guys beating their shins. I mean, that would only damage your shin. It's like beating your knuckles so you could throw a punch. I think we get a cleaner look at the knockdown that was not really called a knockdown. Now, see, that's a kick. Lands in the scoring area of the stomach. The guy goes down. In my opinion, that's not a slip. that's a knockdown. If a boxer punches another boxer in the stomach, the guy goes down, and that's a knockdown. And a kick is supposed to be taken about the same. I believe this would be another angle. You know what? At that angle, I think Cecil Peoples might have called. It didn't really look like it landed on the stomach. That's why I'm not a referee.
Round four.
Yeah, it looks like Garcia has now turned the table. He's trying to be the aggressor at the beginning of the round. See, he keeps doing that lock around the head, which stops all the boxing.
Well, that seems to be Barisat's most effective weapon, is using his hands.
He's trying to. He's not trying to match him with kicks, that's for sure. He's trying to use that left hook. He's using some uppercuts and overhand rights. There's the left hook. But as soon as he gets in close, Garcia grabs him and
okay,
stops it. He snuck a couple of knees in there.
It ties around the arm. New typewriters are wearing. Is that symbolic or?
Yeah, it's just a traditional thing. It doesn't help or hurt how they fight. It's a tradition in Thailand.
We're not going to cut off circulation there.
Okay, yeah, what I'm surprised at is the Iranian's lack of aggression at this point. I think he must have either taken some shots or he's tired.
Well, he's in the corner. It's a dangerous place.
No, he just doesn't. It looks like he's lost a certain amount of energy. Either he got knee to the stomach, and that might have sapped some of his energy. He's just not coming on like he should.
I see the gloves dropping down. I'm sure that's an indicator that.
You see his back up against the ropes. That's not a good place for a fighter, boxer or kickboxer.
Now, as you pointed out, Barisat Mirong, he needs to be inside. He's even turning his back here now.
His mouth is open. He's breathing really heavy. He's fighting in little spurts, and still we're midway through the fight, but he's looking very fatigued. Iranian needs to breathe some air. You see, look, they're in the corner right now with him standing up, breathing deep. I mean, they see the same thing. He needs to get some oxygen in there. He seemed to be losing energy at the end of that round.
Well, you're definitely right. Garcia has gotten into his rhythm, and Barisat Mirong was certainly thrown off his rhythm in that last round. Do you coast during a round, Don? Is there a time when you have to reach within yourself and say, I got to suck up some air here and stay away from the punishment?
There actually is a lot of coasting in a round. The problem is when two fighters are both coasting, it makes for a pretty boring fight. And I think when you get tired, you have no choice but to sit back and try to catch your breath. But these guys should be going all out the last two rounds, and it's still anybody's fight. I mean, I've got Garcia ahead, but unofficially, but still one punch, one kick can turn it all around.
Well, two more rounds. That's a long 4 minutes the way these guys are fighting. Well, initially, Mirong seemed to have got his breath back.
Well, he's trying to do some damage, that's for sure. He's landing good solid kicks and good solid punches. He's doing what he needs to do. He's trying to make something happen here. He's trying to land something that does some damage. Not just score points, he wants to do some damage. You see, he kind of went for a grab. Well, that's from his Draka training.
I guess in the heat of action.
Oh, good. Whoa. Right hand.
That was a knockdown.
That's a knockdown. I'll jump in the ring myself and give him a count. That's a knockdown. Great right hand. That's what he needed. That's what he needed. This could be anybody's game.
Well, that kind of evens the table, but Garcia's ready. He doesn't even want the full 10 count.
Well, I give that 10-8 round, but the thing, what I'm looking at is he still may be suffering from that. He could go down again. But that grab stops the action. That's the one bad thing about the Thai style. If you want to use your hands, the grabbing stops the boxing.
I don't think anybody was more surprised than Garcia where that right hand came from.
Now, but I tell you, Mehrinian needs to get on him. You know, the fighter from Armenia needs to put the pressure on now if he wants to beat this guy. I mean, I don't want to say anything about the judges, but I mean, you got an Armenian fighting an American in America. I mean, he can't be satisfied to sit back.
Well, think about it. Here's where the three knockdown rule comes in.
He's got one knockdown scored. He needs to stay on him. Good clean scores there. You know, if he can win the round and the knockdown, he might be able to pull out a 10-7 round out of this. I mean, if he needs to do a little more damage, he could make a 10-7 round.
That's where that first knockdown becomes really questionable now. Ooh. Coming up to our 16. It's going to be an exciting round. It is too close now.
Well, even with the knockdown, I would still say Garcia unofficially is a little bit ahead, but... if Mehrinian goes all out this round, scores another one, it's up in the air.
The judges, are they the traditional?
I think we're going to see two different looks at the knockdown now. We're going to get a couple of different angles at it. There's it right on the button, you see, right on the chin. You notice that didn't look like it had a lot on it, but, you know, his opponent, Garcia, was coming forward. You see, you watch his head come a little bit forward. And he takes the right hand and goes down. Here he comes forward, boom. Now that's like a head-on collision with cars, you know. If you run into a brick wall, that's bad enough. But when a car's coming at you, you see what happens to a fighter. He goes right to the floor.
Garcia's pride got him up quick.
Last round, the crowd is alive. The electricity in here is it's pretty exciting. Looks like he's looking for that right hand again. He's looking for his time. He's looking for his moment. It landed once, and he thinks he found a soft spot, maybe. Good low kick there to the stomach, but that's not going to do it. He's got to go to the head again. And you know, sooner is better. Mehrinian's trying to lead with the left hook. Get Garcia to block it, come over with the right hand. And then just being a trained fighter, he's finishing with a kick. Start with a kick, end with a kick.
Combinations, but they're not running.
No, he needs to keep the pressure on if he's going to win this. Garcia needs to throw a few more techniques because he's really not landing anything effective so far in his sixth round. Good stiff jab.
30 seconds left.
Yeah, it's close. I'm surprised. I didn't really think that Mehrinian would sit back like this in the last round. Especially after he scored a good clean knockdown. I mean, usually you want to jump on your opponent as soon as that bell rings for the next round.
I think you're right. I think Mehrinian needs this round.
Oh, absolutely. Oh, good left hook.
Yeah.
That's a lead left hook, and he comes with an overhand right.
8 seconds.
And don't hold it back now.
Well, the crowd certainly liked that one.
Well, Mehrinian may have won that last round. It was close, but he may have won. He did land a kind of a overhand right, not much on it, but it is mainly because Garcia was very inactive, probably recuperating from the knockdown.
Now, these are the state of Nevada athletic judges. They see quite a bit of boxing. Do you think sometimes that they might get a little too much emphasis on the boxing?
Well, you know, I when you pick three judges, you don't tell them to, they have to count one over the other, really. I mean, it's what they think is doing the most damage and who is in the most control in a fight. And that's how they judge it on the 10-point must system. And again, if there's no clear dominating fighter, then it's an even round.